Thank you. was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said,
"What are you willing to give me if I hand him over to you?"
They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that time on, he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples approached Jesus and said,
"Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?"
He said,
"Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says, my appointed time draws near. In your house I shall celebrate the Passover with my disciples.'"
The disciples then did as Jesus had ordered and prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he reclined at table with the 12, and while they were eating, he said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me."
Deeply distressed at this, they began to say to him one after the other,
"Surely it is not I, Lord."
He said in reply,
"He who hath dipped his hand into the dish with me is the one who will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes, as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had never been born."
Then Judas, the betrayer, said in reply,
"Surely it is not I, Rabbi."
He answered,
"You have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and giving it to his disciples, said,
"Take and eat, this is my body."
Then he took the cup, giving thanks, gave it to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed on behalf of many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, from now on, I shall not drink this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you new in the kingdom of my Father."
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"This night, all of you will have your faith in me shaken. For it is written, I will strike a shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be dispersed. But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him in reply,
"Though all may have their faith in you shaken, mine will never be."
Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times.
Peter said to him,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And all the disciples spoke likewise. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I go over there and pray."
He took along Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee, and began to feel sorrow and distress. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and keep watch with me."
He advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer, saying,
"My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will."
When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
"So you could not keep watch with me for an hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Withdrawing a second time, he prayed again,
"My Father, if it is not possible that this cup pass without me drinking it, your will be done."
Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open. He left them and withdrew again and prayed a third time, saying the same thing again. Then he returned to his disciples and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Behold, the hour is at hand, when the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. Look.
And stepping forward, they laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. And behold, one of those who accompanied Jesus put his hand to a sword, drew it, and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
"Put your sword back into its sheath, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot call upon my Father, and he will not provide me at this moment with more than 12 legions of angels? But then, how will the scripture be fulfilled, which say that it must come to pass in this way?"
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
"Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I sat teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me. But this has come to pass, that the writings of the prophets will be fulfilled."
Then all of the disciples left him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus led him away to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. Peter was following him at a distance as far as the high priest's courtyard, and going inside, he sat down with the servants to see the outcome. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain false testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Though many false witnesses came forward, finally two came forward and stated, "The high priest rose and addressed him,
'Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?'"
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
"I order you to tell us under oath before the living God whether you are the Christ, the Son of God."
Jesus said to him in reply,
"You have said so, but I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the Father and coming with the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his robes and said,
"He has blasphemed. What further need have we of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What is your opinion?"
They said in reply,
"He serves God."
Then they spat in his face and struck him, while some slapped him, saying, Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. One of the maids came over to him and said, but he denied it in front of everyone, saying,
"I do not know what you are talking about."
As he went out to the gate, another girl saw him and said to those who were there, again he denied it with an oath,
"I do not know the man."
A little later, the bystanders came over and said to Peter, at that he began to curse and to swear,
"I do not know the man."
And immediately a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had spoken, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." He went out and began to weep bitterly. When it was morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. They bound him and led him away and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that Jesus had been condemned, deeply regretted what he had done. He returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying,
"I have sinned in betraying innocent blood."
They said, flinging the money into the temple, he departed and went off and hanged himself. The chief priests gathered up the money, but said, after consultation, they used it to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. That is why that field, even today, is called the Field of Blood. Then was fulfilled what had been said through Jeremiah. some of the Israelites, and they paid it out for the potter's field, just as the Lord had commanded me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, who questioned him.
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus said,
you say so.
And when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he made no answer. Then Pilate said to him,
do you not hear how many things they are testifying against you?
But he did not answer him one word, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now on the occasion of the feast, the governor was accustomed to release to the crowd one prisoner whom they wished. And at that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had assembled, Pilate said to them,
which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus called Christ?
For he knew that it was out of envy that they had handed him over. While he was still seated on the bench, his wife sent him a message. Have nothing to do with that righteous man. I suffered much in a dream today because of him. The chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas, but to destroy Jesus. The governor said to them in reply,
which of the two do you want me to release to you?
They answered,
Barabbas.
Pilate said to them,
then what shall I do with Jesus called Christ?
They all said,
let him be crucified.
But he said,
why? What evil has he done?
They only shouted the louder,
let him be crucified.
When Pilate saw that he was not succeeding at all, but that a riot was breaking out instead, he took water and washed his hands in the sight of the crowd, saying,
I am innocent of this man's blood. Look to it yourselves.
And the whole people said in reply, then he released Barabbas to them. But after he had Jesus scourged, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus inside the praetorium and gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped off his clothes and threw a scarlet military cloak about him. Weaving a crown out of thorns, they placed it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying,
Hail, King of the Jews.
They spat upon him and took the reed and kept striking him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of his cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him off to crucify him. As they were going out, they met a Cyrenian named Simon. This man they pressed into service to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they gave Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he had tasted it, he refused to drink. After they had crucified him, they divided his garments by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over them there. And they placed over his head the written charge against him, this is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and the other on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying, putting it on the reed, gave it to him to drink. But the rest said,
Lord,
were split, tombs were opened, and the bodies of many saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming forth from their tombs after his resurrection, they entered the holy city and appeared to many. The centurion and the men with him who were keeping watch over Jesus feared greatly when they saw the earthquake and all that was happening, and they said, "There were many women there looking on from a distance who had followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was himself a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be handed over. Taking the body, Joseph wrapped it in clean linen and laid it in the new tomb that he had hewn in the rock. Then he rolled a huge stone across the entrance to the tomb and departed. But Mary Magdalene and the other Mary remained sitting there facing the tomb. The next day, the one following the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said,
Jesus was. But because of his statue, he went on the sycamore tree. returning to Jerusalem several times. But as we see the tension increase this time around, he is going to fulfill the promise of the Father. So, the people gave him a red carpet welcome. They threw their palfrons. Some of them threw on their clothes that Jesus would pass on them. At some point, the Pharisees began to complain. And Jesus Christ said to them, you know, because they said that, your disciples are making so much noise. And he said to them, if they do not cry out, Hosanna in the highest, the stones instead will be that. So it was meant to happen. It was designed to go in that way. The question before us, beloved, is this. What do we intend to present unto Jesus? Because the people, the same group of people that shouted Hosanna in the highest, few days from now will be the same people that will cry out, crucify him. For the past 40 days, we have involved ourselves and we have partaken in the works of penance, prayers, and thanksgiving. Those are the fruit we are expected to draw out from the store of what we have done to present to Jesus. If we are able to do that, beloved in the Lord, we shall not be denying Jesus, because at some point during the passion, we see Peter debating with Jesus. Jesus Christ said to him, before the whole crowd, you have denied me three times. And Peter said, that can never happen. That is the danger of following Jesus from a distance. And we should be careful not to fall into that category. Peter was following Jesus from a distance because he was afraid. When he sat on the fire, Peter decided to go and warm himself with that same fire. If we follow Jesus from a distance, we are going to sit with his enemies. Anything that is contrary to the will of God, we will not have a clear sight to see what is happening. If you think for a second, how will Peter even think of that? But because he was afraid, that was why he fell into that. Let us draw a lesson from the life of Peter. We see Judas, because he never believed in the forgiveness of God, he went home and hung himself. Peter, as we shall see, came back, wept bitterly, and seek for repentance. He seek for forgiveness. And Jesus forgave him. Beloved in the Lord, in the same manner, we have followed Jesus from a distance. We have failed in several ways. Let us return to him so that he will cleanse us with the precious blood of the Lamb. Then in that manner, we shall have a purposeful and happy celebration. And we should always remember that as we commemorate this feast, Jesus Christ is not walking into the church, not into any Jerusalem, but rather he wants to have a place in our hearts. Let us open our hearts unto Jesus and let go that which is contrary to his own will. May he bless us as we journey with him. These are our prayers. We ask for Christ our Lord.
Amen.
One Lord Jesus Christ, the living God. Father's will. We love you, United with Him as crucified Savior, and pray
that the suffering and death of Jesus Christ will strengthen the church in holiness and give her new growth. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are to be baptized, confirmed, and receive their first Holy Communion at the Easter Vigil, that these solemn days of Holy Week will be for them and for all of us a time of transforming grace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That civil authorities will use their power with integrity for the common good, protecting the most vulnerable born and unborn. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the children and adult victims at the outburst of evil in the school in Tennessee this past week, and for the comfort and consolation of the parents and families who mourned them, and for the people of Mississippi and Arkansas suffering from the devastation of the tornadoes these past few days, and for all who suffered this day, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Christians who are suffering persecution, especially in Nigeria and the Middle East, may their witness be effective for the redemption of all, and may the passion of Christ bring peace to our world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parishioners and loved ones who are sick or are suffering in any way, especially for Michael McPike, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially Robert Behan, Margaret Morrow, and for Dorothy Rossman, for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those intentions written in our Book of Intentions, and for those we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Through the intercession of our beloved Mother, full of grace, we say, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed are our husband, and blessed is the fruit of our womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, the Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Merciful Father, by his holy cross, your Son has redeemed the world. Help us to be united to Jesus in his passion, and come to share fully in his victory over sin and death. Through Christ our Lord.
Our presentation hymn is O Sacred Head Surrounded, number 383.
Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own means, yet by the sacrifice made once and for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy. Through Christ, O Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, in Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners, and accepting unjust condemnation to save the guilty, his death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels, we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
The mystery of faith.
also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph as spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, and all the saints who have blessed you throughout the ages, not instead to be delivered into the hands of the wicked, and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns